Hello and welcome to video 4.4 on PID control. In the previous video, we've seen how we can model the rigid body kinematics of a rigid body. And we will use this again now for bringing on our example from PID control before. So consider just a simple rigid body like the soccer ball here that is floating, free floating in one dimensional space without any gravity. This means that we have the body itself is located at a certain location x and it's moving in a certain direction x dot. And so we can specify a system model, a really simple system model, where we just say the current position depends on the previous position plus the current speed. And with that we assume that our time constant delta t equals 1. And now assume that we're starting at the origin, so our current position is zero and also our current speed is zero. And then if we look at the time evolution of such a system, we can see that nothing changes because in every new time step we just add zero plus zero, and that means that our ball, that our object will stay exactly at the same point. Now, imagine further that we can now apply at every time instant a certain force, Ft. And just for simplicity, we assume that this force is our control, U, maybe scaled by some factor. And as we know, this force that we apply leads to an acceleration, x double dot. And imagine now that we want to find controls so that the rigid body moves to a desired location of, of 1. And now, as we already know, we could just apply P control to that, which means that we look at the difference between the desired location x dash minus our current location x t from the previous time step. And then we multiply that by a certain control gain k to obtain our control signal. Now, what will happen if we apply this to a rigid body? And then the result looks as follows. We start again now at the origin with our object, and we want to go to a location of 1. So our P controller will generate a large control, in this case of 0.15, because we've set k to 0.15, which will make the object accelerate towards its desired location, and then roughly at 4 seconds time we will hit the desired location. But because we still have some inertia, the object will continue beyond this point and actually overshoot massively up to a position of 2, and then during this time already our controller will generate a negative control output to decelerate the object. And you can see that this leads to a very bad oscillation and actually does not make our object come closer to the desired location. So this is not good. P control for rigid bodies is not sufficient, that are not damped. And the idea is now to use a so-called derivative term. So we have a so-called PD controller then, which where the first part is exactly the same, and then the second part at the same time tries to minimize the distance between the desired speed at, that we try to achieve and our current speed. And this now means that at this location of 1, we desire to have a speed of 0, so our x dot desired equals 0, to make sure that at the end, when we reach this goal, we want to have 0 velocity. And then this leads to the following behavior. You can see now in the bottom plot we still have a k part. We still have a proportional part that will accelerate our body towards the desired location, and we have the blue line shows the differential part now that immediately decelerates our body, but at a smaller overall rate, and this will lead to the nice behavior that we see in the first plot with the red line, that it moves towards our desired location but slows down before it actually hits it. And so you might wonder now what would happen if we set lower gains for this differential part, and then we get again this behavior that we've seen before. So the red line overshoots now to our desired location because the slowdown, this slowing down is not strong enough. On the other hand, if we set higher gains for the differential part, we end up with the following behavior. In this case, it still approaches the desired location nicely, but it takes extremely long, like 25 seconds in this example, and it could be much faster. So this KD can also lead to a slower convergence than in the end. Now let's consider the following. Before, we've just lived in free floating in space, but what would happen if we add gravity to our system? So imagine that next to our control force F that we generate, we add this gravitational constant that accelerates our mass with a certain force. And then the effect is as follows. We start at zero. Again, we want to go to one, but then the funny thing is the object falls down down to 60 meters, and after say 20 seconds or so, the PID control generates sufficiently strong control signal to actually make the object not fall down any further. But this is obviously not what we want. So this would be the case if you just use PD control without gravity compensation, then the quadruro would fall, would never reach its desired location. So what you can do then in such a case is to add an additional term that compensates for the gravity or for any other disturbance that you might be aware of. Directly into our control model, we can now include a term for removing this gravitational force or to compensate this gravitational force directly. Similar to that, any other known dynamic disturbance can be removed in this way. And then the effect is again, as we've seen it before, we can go smoothly from zero to one, just by directly compensating for this. Good. Now, the next problem now is, imagine that we have some systematic errors in our system. For example, our joystick might not be at the right position. The motors might not be equally strong. It could happen that one of the motors is a little bit weaker than another one, for example, because it has a broken propeller or just because it doesn't run as smoothly as another motor. It just might be a little bit unbalanced on the quadrotor, or there might be some external disturbance like wind that constantly pushes away the quadrotor in a certain direction. And if we add something like this, in this example we've added wind from below that makes the object that pushes the object upwards, and this is now again similar to what we had before with the gravitation. The object is now approaching this desired location of one, but it overshoots and it converges on a value that is not our desired value. So it converges here on say 1.3 maybe, and at this location the PD controller generates enough control output to not deviate any further from our desired value, but it also, as you can see, does not converge on our desired value. So the question is, how can we deal with such systematic errors how can we extend our controller to deal with something like this? And the answer now is to estimate this bias term by integrating over time, by integrating all errors that we had before from the very beginning to our current time step. And this is then called a so-called integral term that you can see here on the right. We again have a coefficient or a gain for the integral term, here denoted by KI. This term will build up and then compensate for such errors. So in the example that we've seen before, again, we get some overshooting because initially this integral term is zero, and so the algorithm doesn't know that that we have a disturbance. But as soon as we overshoot and then we have and observe this error, this integral builds up and then compensates for it over time, and you can see that now our controller nicely converges on the desired value. And in the bottom plot, you can now see how these three terms actually contribute to this behavior. So we have the red line just corresponding, the bright red line corresponding to our proportional control output, the blue line corresponding to our differential output, and the bright green line corresponding to our systematic integral term. Good. So this is this is a bit tricky to use the integral term. It's generally fine for steady state systems, so systems that can actually reach their desired location, and then it's very reasonable and very good to do that. But it might also happen that you have a system that can never reach a certain location, and this then might create a so-called wind-up effect, which can lead to a disaster or at least to a strong delay in your controller. And now to see why this is a problem, consider the following example. Imagine we want that the quadrotor goes to a certain location, but then on its way gets stuck in a tree, so it cannot reach the steady state. And then it's interesting to look at the effect of this being stuck on the integral term. And then we see the following behavior. The quadrotor goes to a location, is sent to a location of 10 in this example, so it goes quickly towards this location. But then roughly at a position of 5, it gets stuck in the tree. And from there on, this integral term keeps building up because it realizes that it needs to give more power to the motors, apparently, to reach its goal location, but it can't because it is stuck. And so this integral term grows larger and larger, as you can see in the bottom plot. And if we send now the quadrotor at point 10, at time step 10, back to the origin, it won't go because this integral term still outweighs our proportional controller that tries to move the quadrotor back. And this is why the integral term is sometimes a bit difficult and dangerous to be used. Another problem, of course, is that we generally not only have one degree of freedom that we try to control, but typically multiple. In case of the Ardrone, we have 4 degrees of freedom. As you know, we can go forward, sidewards, we can rotate, and we can change the flying height. And this is common with many systems. This is then called a so-called MIMO system, multiple input, multiple output. Also, it would be, of course, nice from a theoretical point of view to control all degrees of freedom at the same time with the same controller. Most often, these controllers are just being decoupled, so you have 2 or 4 independent PID controllers, each one just controlling 1 degree of freedom. And then, of course, the plant or the system that you're looking at has couples all of these degrees of freedom. But as long as this coupling is very loose, it doesn't hurt to assume for the controllers that these degrees of freedom are actually separate. Another interesting question is then how to choose the coefficients. The problem here is that if you make the gains too large, as we've seen, it can easily lead to overshooting and oscillations. However, if you make the gains too small, then it might take a very long time to converge. Still, a good heuristic then is to increase, start with small gains and then incrementally increase them until you see a good behavior. If you see oscillations, you know that you've made them too large, and so on. There are some heuristic methods that you can follow that tell you how to tune these parameters, but in practice, people often do it just by thumb, try out different values, and finding then a parameter setting where you see a reasonably good behavior. Of course, there are more advanced techniques here, and the whole field of control theory studies these problems. But for our case, and for especially for the simulator that you've been using, that you'll be using, this is completely sufficient. Another thing is, of course, that we are not only having one controller typically, but a whole sequence of controllers. For example, as you've seen before, in hardware we already have motor speed controllers at every motor of the quadrotor, which internally runs not necessarily a PID controller, or it depends on what motor you have. If you can sense the speed, then there is typically something like a P controller inside. And then on the next level, on the Ardrone, for example, this happens on board, is the attitude estimation, where you use the gyroscopes and the accelerometers to estimate the orientation of the quadrotor and then generate suitable attitude control commands. And on top of that, you might have a localization module that, you know, given the camera images or your GPS signal, computes your position, and then you might have a PID controller that controls your position. And even above this layer, you might have a trajectory generator and trajectory control that generates waypoints to which you want to send the quadrotor. And it's important to note here that you can just stack different controllers above each other. This is then called cascaded control. And this works well as long as the dynamics of the outer system are by a magnitude, at least a magnitude, slower than the dynamics of the internal system. So for the internal controller, it then appears, the set point then appears to be static, and for the outer controller, the dynamics of the internal system are so fast that it also appears to immediately converge. Good. So to look at an example now, the Ardrone also uses several control loops. We have, mostly from our perspective, we have an inner loop that runs on the embedded PC that controls the attitude and the speed of the quadrotor. And then the outer loop runs on a laptop and implements the position control. And these two control loops run at different speeds. The internal loop runs, we don't really know, but it probably runs at around 1 kilohertz. While the outer loop runs, depending on your wireless connection, runs at approximately 15 to 20 hertz. And there is another interesting insight. The PID controller is actually equivalent to a spring damper system. So you can imagine that you have your quadrotor that's supposed to go to this desired location, and it's actually being pulled like with virtual springs towards this desired location. And if you look very closely on this video, you can see how this quadrotor moves back to its set point, and you can see how it's being damped by the D-term of the PID controller, and how it's being pulled towards its set point using the P part. And this is actually a very nice demo that we've published as open source. And if you'd like, if you have an Ardrone at home, you can just download this demo. You need a Linux computer running ROS on it, but it's all very well described on this wiki page. So please feel free to try this out. Good. So to summarize the lesson of this video, we've looked now at full PID control. Remember again, P stands for the proportional term, I stands for the integral term, and D stands for the derivative term. And we've seen how we can stack multiple of such controllers in a cascaded control, and how we can decouple MIMO systems that have multiple inputs and multiple outputs.